Yeah. Is it visual?
Yes, we can. Yes, we can see.
Okay. So till now, what we have discussed, so we have discussed what the basics of ScaleWC, then the file structure, and we have seen the data binding. And in the last session, we have seen about the public properties in JavaScript. So there are some other kind of properties available to be can be used in LWC. So we are going to discuss those things today. So our agenda will be track properties. So what is track property in LWC? What it does? Where we can use it? Then the private properties. So what is the difference between public and private properties, and why we need it? Then reactive property, data types. So what are the data types that are reactive in LWC, and what are the data types that are not reactive in LWC? Then Boolean properties. So we will get we will understand the behavior of Boolean properties if we define it. How does it behave? And in the last, we will see the reflect property. So maybe if you are writing a custom application, so you might have to do the automation testing. So it is important to write your component in such a way that the screen reader reads the property correctly. So you will need to understand the reflect properties as well. So let's move forward. So before talking about track properties, let me recall about the public properties we have discussed in the last session. So if I open my project, just give me 1 minute. So I am opening an old project that I have created in the last session. There I have created some component. So I can show it with you. Selecting this folder. It will open the folder. So in the course tab, LWC, I have all my components I have created. And if I show you API property component, it does not have. Give me 1 more minute. Yeah. So we have talked about public properties. So to define a property as a public, you need to annotate your property with @API decorator. So whenever you decorate a property with @API, it becomes public. So whenever you are calling a component from other component, so you can set the value of this property from the parent component wherever you are calling it. So this is called public properties. So if you are defining a public property with a Boolean value, so you can't set it as true, so it will always be false. You can't, if you try to set a public property as true, let's see what it does say to you. It is not a valid scenario. So if you try to save it, and if you let me try to deploy it, does it give error or not? Let me see. My linting is still initializing, so just give me 1 or 2 more minutes. Once this initializing is completed, I will get the option to deploy. Okay, so you get to know about the public property in the now what is track property. So we already have public property. which are reactive in nature, which we can set the value from some other component. So now what is track property? So let's say I am writing a component and I don't want to expose the property to be used from some other component. So you have a component one and you have component two. So you are going to call component two inside component one. I don't want to expose a property that owns by component two to component one. So in that scenario, you will use track property. So track property is only available in the component which owns it. So here is a component snippet I have pasted on the slide. So simple track.js. So here I have defined a property called item name. So it's the item name is annotated with @track. So whenever you annotate a property with @track, it becomes track property. It is reactive in nature. So whenever the value of this property gets changed, the screen re-renders. Let's see an example to get more understanding. So now, see, before that, so I have defined a public property with true, and it gives me an error: invalid public property initialization for public property. Boolean public property should not be initialized to true. Consider initializing the property to false. So you can't initialize a public property with true. So it should always be false. Let's go back to track properties. So if you see, I have a simple track component here. So in the HTML, what I have a button with a label called change item, and on click I am firing a method. And whatever I have a property over here called item name. What I am doing with this property? So this property have initial value as milk. Whenever button gets clicked, I am changing this property value to bread. So let's see this in action. Let me log into the Salesforce. Here I have already deployed it. And once I am logged in, I think I have added it on the page also, so I don't need to add it on page. Meanwhile, if you have any question about public properties, you can ask me till it's open. Okay, here it is. I have an application page called Lightning Wave Component. Here I have added the component. So this one, this milk and change item button. So this is a component I have added on the application page. So the current value is milk, as I have defaulted it. Whenever user comes and click on the button called change item, the value gets changed to bread. So what it does, on click of button, it's changing the value, and the HTML file gets re-rendered by itself. So how it is re-rendering? It is re-rendering because of track decorator. So track decorator makes a property reactive. So whenever value gets changed, the screen re-render itself, and you can't access this property if you try to call it in some other component. So let's say I have a parent component over here. I am trying to call simple track component, and I want to set the value of item name. If you see, I am not getting the property name. Whereas this is another component called bool. So what it has? It has a public property, and when you try to call the same component, bool, and then if you search for it, so you get the property name. So what it says? It says public properties can be used in other component. You can access it in some other component. You can set the value of public property from other component. Whereas if a property is annotated with track, you can't set the value of it from other component, or it can't be accessed. So it is clear now.
Yes.
Now, okay. Do you have any question?
No. I'm saying it's okay. Yes.
Okay. Now, in the Spring 20, what happened is, before a Spring 20, to make a property reactive, either you have to annotate it with @API or @track or @wire. After Spring 20, what Salesforce has done? So there is one release update. Let me show you. That says you no longer need @track to make a property reactive. Let me show you. Yeah. So this has come in a Spring 20. So you should always keep checking the release notes, because let's say something I have told today that might change tomorrow, because Salesforce has given some update on it. So what Salesforce has given it, so initially to make a property reactive, we need track. But after a Spring 20, this is no longer required. So even without annotating a property with @track, any property defined in LWC is reactive by default. But there is one exception. So what is that exception? If your property is of type object, so in this case here I have a property called full name, and this is a type of object, so it has two attributes, first name, last name. If you want to make this property as reactive, let's say first name changes to John. I want my HTML to re-render itself when the value changes. So you must annotate a object property with @track. So this is an exception. Let's see it in action. So I have item name annotated with track. As per Salesforce, after a Spring 20, I don't need it. So I have GS0 org. Spring 20 is yet not delivered in your org, but I have pre-dev org. So before a Spring 20 generally available in my developer box, I have already Spring 20 enabled, so I can test it. So what I have done, I have removed the @track. And let me deploy this component to org, and we will check whether it is reactive in nature or not. So if a property is not reactive, even if the value gets changed on UI, it will not reflect. So I am deploying it. And once it is deployed, I will refresh and show it to you. And let me till the time it deploys, let me define the property of type object name. And let me show you. So I have a property full name annotated with track, and I will write another property without track. So just keep it name, and it will have first name, last name, and this will be without track. And let me change it. So instead of that, use this. So after that, okay, let me write one more button over here. Name it check reactive properties. Handle click one and define this method over here. And here we will try to change this dot full name and same thing for name. And here as well, Sanket Kumar. Let me change my first name to Kumar. And let me add full name and name on the UI as well. So here I am adding full name and then name. Okay, let me add some break tag. So what I have done over here, so I have one property called item name without at the rate track. I have another, so this is pretty data type string. Here I have defined a property of type object. So it has two attribute, first name and last name. And this is annotated with at the rate track. I have another property called name. This is without, it is also of type object, and it has two attribute, same thing, first name and last name. Now I have two buttons over here. So I have one button called change item and another button called change reactive properties. So on click of change item, what I am doing, I am changing the item name value to bread. Then I'm changing the full name value. So initially it is blank. What I'm now doing, I am setting a initial value. So first name is John, last name is Doe. So there is difference. If the initial value is null or blank, and if you set the value to John, something else, so that time it will be reactive. And once you it has some value, if you again try to change it, that time if the property is not annotated with at the rate track, then it will not be reactive. So let's see in action and we will get the clear understanding. So I'm deploying it. And I will refresh. Let me go and refresh the screen. No, it has not refreshed. Let me refresh it. So Lightning components does create issue when you
you can move in Classic and then come back on Lightning, it will work.
Okay.
Not done, just
no. Okay, let me try it in Playground, so it will be faster, don't worry.
Actually it's caching the data, that's why sometimes it's not reflecting.
Yeah. Let me try it in Playground. So this example quickly. Let me remove all the code from here. And from JavaScript as well. So I'm editing everything. Copy my code from here. And in JavaScript. Yeah. Okay. One minute. So full name dot first name. Let me show it. Full name dot first name. And name dot first name. So I have item name, full name dot first name, and so these are three property. So initially, without pressing any button, what I have value as blank. So it does not have any value. That's why anything is not coming on the screen. When I click change item button, so what I am doing here, I am changing item name to bread, Then full name dot first name is equal to John. So John has appeared here. Then name dot first name is equal to Sanket. So Sanket has come over here. So this is reactive because initially the property is null and now I am setting value to something. So irrespective of whether it's track or not, whether you have annotated a property with track or not, and the data type is object, that is reactive for the first time. Once it has, once we have some value over here, if again I try to set the value, so if I click on check reactive properties, so this thing has changed to do. Just give me 1 minute. It's contradicting. Okay. Now let me try like this. So let me remove it, and if I press it, so I have set the value, it's John. And if I again click on check reactive properties, setting the value, so it's contradicting. I'm not sure why it's happening, saying if we assign a new value to one of the object, the component does not render because the property aren't object. Okay, I think I will check this for next session. I'm explain it to you why it's contradicting. So the thing is, if you have any data type, any property with data type object, and if it is plain object, so that's fine. But if it's not a plain object, so let me go back to slide and explain what I'm trying to say. So let's say you have object with complex parameters inside it. So complex attributes, you are fetching the object fields, then child relationship, everything. So at the rate track will not be able to capture all the changes. So there is a limitation in the depth of changes can be tracked. So you might need to reconstruct your property as a plain object. Also, there are some other things. So don't overuse track. Let's say you have defined 50 property in your components. So you should not annotate every property with at the track. So what you need to do, you need to check whether what property really needs to re-render. And also Salesforce has given now you, Salesforce has makes every property as reactive. So you really don't need every time at the right track. So only thing you need at the right track is when you are dealing with objects. So if you're not dealing with objects, you don't need track if you are trying to limit a property within a particular component. Then also you can decorate multiple properties with track. So that's what I have shown here. So you have two property, you can annotate both properties track. But what you can't do is, let's say you have API imported API as well. What you can't do is you can't annotate a single property with both at the rate track API at the rate track and at the rate API. This is invalid scenario. So either you can annotate a property with track, or either you can annotate a property with API. You can't annotate a property both at the same time. Okay, then
simply we can say API is a public property and track is a private property, right?
Yeah, track is a private property. Of course, it is a private property, but it's a reactive. It's reactive.
Private reactive, right?
Yeah. Now, there are some more insights on reactive property data type. So this is what we have already discussed. So what I was trying to say is there are some limitation on the depth of changes track for rendering in reactive property. So as I let's say you are getting a object info from Apex method or by calling an API for metadata API. So object info consists of child relationship infos, its field infos, everything. So the object structure is quite complex and it has some depth. Even if you have annotated a property with @track, your screen does not re-render because track is not able to track the changes in the depth happening. So let's say something gets changed for child, so that @track will not re-render itself. So you need to be cautious about that. So how you will deal with those scenarios? So you have to reconstruct those objects as a plain object. When I say plain object, so this is something called plain object. If you have very complex, let's say this is an object and you have object inside object, so that's not a plain object, right? If you have, let's say, something complex, this like this. So if you have a structure, let me show you. If you have a structure like this, so this is a object info. So it has some depth, right? These are all information about object. And if you see, if it is having any child relationship, it's giving data about them also. So these kind of objects, there are limitations. So @track will not be able to track the every changes happening in this particular object. So be cautious while using these things. Let's say I want to get the object info for account. So for account is having relationship with these objects. So these are child relationships. So our @track decorator can't track the every changes happening over here. What are the things that can be tracked with @track property? So what are the things that a reactive property can track? So that is primitive value. Let's say it's a string or number, boolean. Pretty simple. So primitive value can be tracked. Then plain objects created with this syntax. So what I have shown over here, like this. Then array created with, so if you have any array, so that is also reactive in nature. Whenever you annotate a property with track and it has some depth that can't be tracked, if you open the browser console, so a warning will be logged over there, something like this. So it says property X of object VM track date is set to a non-trackable object, which means changes into that object cannot be observed. So you will get to know where are you making wrong. So it will be helpful for you. So if you are running any component, always try to see the console log as well. What you are getting there? Are you getting any issue over there or not? Then coming to Boolean properties. So let's understand about Boolean properties. Let me close these files. So I have a component called bool. So I have defined a public property here called so, and I have defaulted it false. I have another parent component. It's called LWC component. It has a file called parent.html. So I have tried calling it in a various way. Okay, so I have called thrice, and what I am trying to understand, so how does this Boolean property behaves? The first time I have not set the value of so I have make I haven't done anything. Next time I have just written so. So how does it take whether it will be true or false? And then in the third time, what I have said, I have assigned a computed value to this public property. So let's see what I have in JavaScript file. In JavaScript file, what I have used a getter. So getter is called computed value, and I am simply returning true. So basically, what I am doing over here is I am passing a true value to this property. When I deploy it and see on the screen, what I can see is what value I am expecting. First time it's showing me false. Second time it's showing me true. Third time it's showing me true. The default value of so is false. So when I call the component bool over here, I haven't passed any value for so. So the default value for the boolean property will be always false. If you not pass any computed value, and if you just write the property name while calling the component, it will be considered as true. So I have not passed any value, but I have just written so. It means it is passing a true value to child component called boolean. It's setting value as true. Hence, you can see here true. And in third time, I have passed a computed value. So let's say you have to execute a logic, and then you have to decide the value of this property. So what I am doing over here, I am returning true, and hence it is setting the value as true. So now you get to understand, while working with Lightning Web component, if you have defined any public property of type boolean, then you can use these three various way. So if you don't call it, by default it will be false. If you just write the property name, it will be considered as true. And if you pass a computed value, whatever you are passing the value, that will be set as the computer the value of the property. So is this clear?
Yes, I can.
Okay, thank you. Then coming to private property. So track is also private property, but it's reactive in nature. If you don't annotate a property with anything, so see this thing, todo item.js. Here I have defined three things. One is item title that have been annotated with @API. This is public. Another thing is item ID. It hasn't been annotated with any decorator, so it's simply called private. And if you annotate a property with @track, it's called internal and reactive. So when it is internal, it means a private. So it's private and reactive, internal and reactive. So you need to be clear about this thing. And you already know the difference when you annotate a property with @API, @track, or if you don't decorate it with this thing. Okay.
Okay.
Now this is the last topic of today's session. So this is something. This will come when. So let's say you are building a custom component, custom application for communities or anything, anywhere you want to, you intend to use it. So you must have a testing team, right? They will be doing the automation testing. So while doing automation testing, what they will do, they will read the screen, they will fetch the property name, they will fetch the value, they will set the value from there. You have to set that index, a tab index, everything. So how does this thing work? So I have an example over here. Let me show it to you. So okay, not here. Okay, let me copy it from here and creates a component. I have reflect properties. Yeah. I have an example over here. So what it says, so let's say I have defined a property called private title. What I am doing, I am setting the attribute, set attribute. So I am setting a value for title as the value of this property. And when this particular component renders on the screen, and when you inspect the element, how this component looks over there. So let me create and show it to you. So let me create my component. Do I have my component? Yes, I have my component over here. Sorry. Okay. So I have the component over here. Let me add it on the screen and let's see it. I'm going to add the my component on the screen and let me show you what does it mean. I have parent of my component. So basically what I have, so this is a child component. I have called this component inside this one. So that's why I am adding this component so that it renders. Let me remove other components from the screen. Okay, so I just have parent of my component. I'm saving it and going back. So as I do not have anything on the UI, I have not written anything on the HTML. Let me go to browser console. That's why anything is not coming on the screen. But don't worry about it. Let me go to elements and so let me search it. Yeah. See this. So my component is rendering like this. See my component. Title is coming over the component to see. So let's understand the code first. So this is my component. What I am doing, so I have a property called private title and I am setting title, that is a reflect property, with the value this dot private title, and I am passing this value from here. So I am passing the title from here over the component to see me. That's why when your testing team will come and inspect it, so they can be able to see this value. And tab index also, so tab index I am setting from here, connected callback I have set the tab index as 0. So here tab index is 0. Now what we do is, let me remove. So basically we have a title as annotated with @API. That's why I am able to pass the value from here. I can't be able to pass the value for private title because it's annotated with track. Okay. So now let me remove, let me comment it. Remove it. So basically, reflect property will come in picture when you are dealing with public property. So whenever you are annotating a property with @API, you must do these things. So you must do, you must expose it for the testers so that they can read the screen. Okay, so it will be helpful for them. Let me deploy. Let me deploy the parent of my component as well. Something has failed. Let me see. API is defined but never used. Okay. Bad content is. Redeploy it. That time it does not get deployed because I have defined API but I haven't used anywhere. So you should only define those things which you are intending to use in your code. Otherwise it will give an error. Now let me refresh it and check how does it coming. So if you do not set the title attribute, it will not be available to read for screen readers. Let me search parent. My component. If you see, I have not set attribute of title as set attribute, so it's not coming over here. So it is not available for a screen reader or the testers to get the title value. So this is the best practice you should do while writing the component. So allowing property to appear as attribute is especially important when creating accessible components. Testing team will always ask for this. They want to read the property you are using. When you take a control of an attribute by exposing it as public property, the attribute no longer appear in the HTML output by default. So as soon as you define a property with @API, they will not re-rendered on the HTML. So by default, you have to do those things. So this set attribute is a method you need to call, and if you call it, it will be available on the HTML as well. And this is how tab index. You can set anything. So tab index, title. There are many attributes which you can set. If you want to know all those attributes, what you can do, if you scroll, if you, you can refer this screen, and here are so you can set the attribute value for this four area active controls described by details error message. So these things you can set the values, all these things you can set the value. If you want to remove from the HTML, you can call the remove attribute method. So you can either use set attribute or remove attribute. I will share this link, or you can go and search for reflect property in developer guide. You will get to know about it.
Sure, Sankit.
Sankit, I have a doubt.
Okay.
Yeah, like in Aura, we add the available for all page types. So that will show in the Lightning App Builder custom components. So yeah. Over here, what we have to do so that in Lightning App Builder, in the custom components, it will show there.
Okay, I have not yet overcome there, but as I have built so many components, let me explain it to you.
Okay.
So when you create any component, by default, you will get three file, right? HTML, JavaScript, yes. And then JavaScript meta XML file. Uh-huh. So if you go to meta XML file, you will get this syntax by default, correct?
Okay.
So it has API version 47 is exposed as false. Now, you want to expose this to your Salesforce. So you want to expose this to home page, to record page, to application page. So what you need to do is, first you need to expose it as true. Then you have to use targets tag, and inside targets you need to write the target. So target will be my Lightning record page, Lightning app page, Lightning home page, wherever you want to use it. Okay. So I will explain these things in more detail. Now you can use just this. So there are many things. So basically, this is a configuration file. It defines all the metadata value of the component. So where it can be used. Let's say you intend to use a component only on opportunity record page. You don't want to expose it to any other object record page. So everything can be controlled from the configuration file. So I will explain it later. Till the time I reach there, just you need to know, if you want to expose it, first you need to do as make it as true. Then you need to use targets tag, and then target inside target you need to write the target name.
Okay. So once these changes are done, again we have to deploy to the org and then check.
Yes.
Or automatically it will sync.
No. So this code I am writing locally, right? So I need to deploy this thing to my org. So right click and just deploy it.
Okay. Yeah.
Any other question you want to ask, as I am finished for today?
Yeah, for the track annotation also. Actually I joined the class 2-3 minutes late. So just want to understand, in the track annotation, it will be like a private annotation, and for any changes in the front end, it will display the value. That's it, right?
Yes. So let me go back to the slide where it explained clearly. So this thing. So if you annotate any property with @track, it makes it reactive, and it keeps the property to be used only for internal. So you can't access it from any other component.
Correct. So now suppose the track state x is equal to 100. So suppose the previous value was 50, and now on a button click, it changes to 100. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So just an example. Okay. So yeah. On a button click, it changes to 100. It will display in the application. If we show it, it will display it as 100.
Yeah, so
track annotation, right?
Yeah, so if it is annotated track, any changes, as it is a plain object, any changes in this will be automatically reflected on the UI. So you don't need to do anything.
So suppose I don't annotate as track. So nothing will show, or the previous value will only show?
No. So I have what I said after a spring 20. So a spring 20 is about to come in your all. Okay. Right. So till now, as a spring 20 is not generally available, so if you don't annotate a property with @track, the value will be changed for the property, but it will not re-render on the UI.
On the UI,
it will remain 50 or 100, whatever you have. But if you in the backend, it's 100.
Okay.
But after a spring 20, even if you have not annotated a property with @track, every property you are defining is reactive in nature unless the property is of type data type of type object, and it's not a plain object. So if you have an object that's not a plain object, then you must annotate that property with @track if you want to track the changes.
Okay. What do you mean by plain object?
So plain object means the structure of the object is pretty simple, right? You have X and Y attribute.
Okay, like that. Okay.
Yeah. So if you have complex structure, so that is not, it has some depth. You have some relationship between the objects.
Okay. Correct. Okay, got it, Sandeep. Thanks.
Okay. Any more questions? Okay, if you don't have any questions, thank you for attending this call. On the next session, we will be going to discuss about different ways of calling Apex method in LWC, and we will also see some native methods to get the information from server in LWC. So next session is going to be a good one, because Apex and creating a record, updating a record, deleting a record, getting the record pick list value, and how if you have written a custom Apex method, all those things we are going to cover in the next session.
Sure. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you for joining. Let's end this session. We will meet in next. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.